Dear students, welcome for our lecture series on geography. In today's episode, we are going to discuss the concept of evolution under the topic Darwin's theory of evolution. Darwin is the father of evolution, and today's topic can be discussed under the following subheadings. They are the history of evolution, Darwin's theory of evolution, the process of natural selection, types of evolution, and drawbacks of Darwin's theory of evolution. We can start with the history of evolution. The theory of evolution is one of the greatest intellectual revolutions of human history, drastically changing our perception of the world and of our place in it. Charles Darwin put forth a coherent theory of evolution and combined great evidence in support of this theory. In Darwin's time, most scientists fully believed that each organism and each adaptation was the work of the Creator. Linnaeus established the system of biological classification that we use today, and did so in the spirit of cataloging God's creations. The idea that traits are passed down from parents to offspring has been around since the ancient Greek philosopher's time. The late 1700 saw the first theories that species changed over time. The scientists like the Comte de Buffon and Charles Darwin's grandfather, Erasmus Darwin, both proposed that species changed over time, but neither man could explain how or why they changed. John Baptist Lamarck, a student of the Comte de Buffon, was the first to publicly state species changed over time. The first systematic presentation of evolution was put forth by the French scientist Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck in 1809. Lamarck described a mechanism by which he believed evolution could occur. This mechanism was known as the inheritance of acquired characteristics. On the other hand, part of his theory was incorrect. Lamarck proposed that acquired traits were passed down to offspring. After that, Georges Cuvier was able to prove that part of the theory incorrect, but he also had evidence that there were once living species that had evolved and gone extinct. Cuvier believed in catastrophism, meaning these changes and extinctions in nature happened suddenly and violently. After Cuvier, James Hutton and Charles Lyell countered Cuvier's argument with the idea of uniformitarianism. This theory said changes happen slowly and accumulate over time. But the theory of natural selection was most famously explained by Charles Darwin in his book On the Origin of Species in 1859. In this book, Darwin proposed that individuals with traits most suitable to their environments lived long enough to reproduce and pass down those desirable traits to their offsprings. If an individual had less favorable traits, they would die and not pass on those traits. Over time, only the fittest traits of the species survived. Eventually, after enough time passed, these small adaptations would add up to create new species. The concept of Darwin's theory is also called as survival of the fittest. Along with Darwin, there was another person who comes with the same idea, Alfred Russel Wallace. Wallace also had evidence and came to the same conclusions as Darwin around the same time. They both worked together for a short time and together presented their results, prepared with evidence from all over the world due to their various travels. Darwin and Wallace received favorable responses in the scientific community about their ideas. One very important part of the theory of evolution through natural selection is the understanding that individuals cannot evolve, they can only adapt to their environments. Those adaptations add up over time, and eventually the entire species has evolved from what it was like earlier. This can lead to new species forming and sometimes extinction of older species. Coming to Darwin's theory of evolution. The evolution is a scientific theory that essentially states species change over time. There are many different ways of species change, but most of them are based on the idea of natural selection. The theory of evolution through natural selection was the first scientific theory that put together evidence of change through time as well as a mechanism for how it happens. In 1800, scientists found some kinds of fossils and they were very aware of homologous and vestigial structures. Many scientists suspected that some kind of evolution had given rise to living things around them. However, they had no unifying theory to explain how evolution might have occurred. Two scientists led the way in the search of mechanism of evolution. The first was Jean Lamarck. The second was Charles Darwin. Darwin got his idea about evolution while reading a book called Principles of Population by Thomas Malthus. Malthus stated that a human population is growing without check and it would double every 25 years. But resources such as food, air, and water cannot increase at the same rate. Consequently, human beings are involved in an intense struggle for existence, competing for the limited resources. This idea helped Darwin to find out the mechanism behind the evolution. The Darwin combined this idea of competition with his other observations and explained how evolution could occur. First, he stated that variation exists among individuals of a species. Second, he stated that scarcity of resources in a growing population would lead to competition between individuals of the same species. This is because all species use the same limited resources. Such competition would lead to the death of some individuals while others would survive. From this reasoning, Darwin concluded that individuals having advantageous variations are more likely to survive and reproduce than those without the advantageous variations. Natural selection is Darwin's most famous theory. It states that evolutionary change comes through the production of variation in each generation and differential survival of individuals with different combinations of these variable characters. Individuals with characteristics which increase their probability of survival will have more opportunities to reproduce, and their offspring will also benefit from the heritable advantageous character. So, over time, these variants will spread through the population. Darwin coined the term natural selection to describe the process by which organisms with favorable variations survive and reproduce at a higher rate. An inherited variation that increases an organism's chance of survival in a particular environment is called as adaptation. over many generations, and adaptation could spread throughout the entire species. In this way, according to Darwin, evolution by natural selection would occur. Darwin was influenced by observations made during his youthful voyage as naturalist on the survey ship Beagle. On the Galapagos Islands, he noticed the slight variations that made tortoises from different islands recognizably distinct. Now, we shall move on to the process of natural selection. The primary mechanism of change over time is natural selection. This mechanism causes changes in the properties of organisms within lineages from generation to generation. Darwin's process of natural selection has four components. First one, variation. Organisms within populations exhibit individual variation in appearance and behavior. These variations may involve body size, hair color, facial markings, voice properties, or number of offsprings. On the other hand, some traits show little or no variation among individuals. For example, number of eyes in vertebrates. Next is inheritance. Some traits are consistently passed on from parents to offspring. Such traits are heritable, whereas other traits are strongly influenced by environmental conditions and show weak heritability. High rate of population growth. Most populations have more offspring each year than local resources can support, leading to a struggle for resources. Each generation experiences substantial mortality. Next is differential survival and reproduction. Individuals possessing traits well suited for the struggle for local resources will contribute more offspring to the next generation. From one generation to the next, the struggle for existence favors individuals with some variations over others, and thereby changes the frequency of traits within the population. This process is natural selection. In order to operate natural selection on a trait, the trait must possess heritable variation and must confer an advantage in competition for resources. If one of these requirements does not occur, then the trait does not experience natural selection. Evidence for natural selection. Let us look at an example which gives clear picture of natural selection. Industrial melanism is a phenomenon that affected over 70 species of moths in England. It has been studied in the peppered moth Biston betularia. Prior to 18th century, the typical moth of a species had a light pattern. Dark colored or melanic moths were rare. During the Industrial Revolution, dust and other industrial waste darkened tree trunks and killed off lichens. The light colored morph of the moth became rare and the dark morph became abundant. In 1819, the first melanic morph was seen. By 1886, it was far more common, illustrating rapid evolutionary change. Eventually, light morphs were common in only a few locales, far from industrial areas. The cause of this change was thought to be selective prediction by birds, which favored camouflage coloration in the moth. The natural selection can ultimately lead to the formation of new species. Sometimes, many species evolve from a single ancestral species. Similarities in skeletal and muscular structure of Hawaiian horny creepers led scientists to conclude that the 23 species of honey creepers evolved from one ancestral species. such an evolutionary pattern in which many related species evolved from a single ancestral species is called adaptive radiation. Adaptive radiation most commonly occurs when a species of organisms successfully invades an isolated region where few competing species exist. If new habitats are available, new species will evolve. Adaptive radiation. The natural selection is the cornerstone of evolutionary theory. It provides the mechanism for adaptive change. Any change in the environment is likely to lead to local adaptation. Any widespread population is likely to experience different environmental conditions in different parts of its range. As a consequence, it will soon consist of a number of subpopulations that differ slightly or even considerably. The following is an example that illustrates the adaptation of populations to local conditions. The Galapagos finches are the famous example from Darwin's voyage. Each island of Galapagos that Darwin visited had its own kind of finch found nowhere else in the world. Some had beaks adapted for eating large seeds, others for small seeds. Some had parrot-like beaks for feeding on birds and fruits, and some had slender beaks for feeding on small insects. One used a thorn to probe for insect larvae in wood like some woodpeckers do. To Darwin, it appeared that each was slightly modified from an original colonist, probably the finch on the mainland of South America, some 600 miles to the east. It is probable that adaptive radiation led to the formation of so many species because other birds were few or absent, leaving empty niches to fill, and because the numerous islands of the Galapagos provided ample opportunity for geographic isolation. Coming to types of evolution. The evolution over time can follow several different patterns. Factors such as environment and predation pressure can have different effects on the ways in which species exposed to them evolve. The three main types of evolution are divergent, convergent, and parallel evolution. Divergent evolution. When people hear the word evolution, they most commonly link to divergent evolution, the evolutionary pattern in which two species gradually become increasingly different. This type of evolution often occurs when closely related species diversify to new habitats. On a large scale, divergent evolution is responsible for the creation of the current diversity of life on Earth from the first living cells. On a smaller scale, it is responsible for the evolution of humans and apes from a common primate ancestor. Next is convergent evolution. Convergent evolution causes difficulties in fields of study such as comparative anatomy. Convergent evolution takes place when species of different ancestry begin to share analogous traits because of a shared environment or other selection pressure. For example, whales and fish have some similar characteristics since both had to evolve methods of moving through the same medium, that is water. Next is parallel evolution. Parallel evolution occurs when two species evolve independently of each other, maintaining the same level of similarity. Parallel evolution usually occurs between unrelated species that do not occupy the same or similar niches in a given habitat. In addition to these patterns of evolution, some species evolve in relation to each other in other ways. Species that live in a close relationship with each other, such as a predator-prey or symbiotic relationship, often evolve adaptations to each other in a process called coevolution. In predator-prey or parasitic relationships, this evolution can rise into rapid changes in offense or defense, known as coevolutionary arms race. Coming to evidences for evolution, there are some evidences to prove the process of evolution. Some of them are ancient organism remains, fossil layers, and similarities among organisms alive today. Ancient organisms remains. Darwin found many types of remains of ancient organisms. In addition to fossil layers, he saw other fossils, bones, insects in hardened tree sap and petrified wood. Darwin and scientists today have discovered that the ancient organisms whose remains they find look like organisms alive today because they are the living organisms' ancestors or evolved from a common ancestor. For example, Megatherium was probably an ancient ancestor of tree sloth that exists today. Next is fossil layers. Fossil layers are fossils that formed in sedimentary rock. Sedimentary rock is a rock that is formed in layers by the depositing and pressing of sediments on top of each other. Because sediments sometimes include once living organisms, sedimentary rock often contains a lot of fossils. Fossils are once living organisms that have been turned into rock, in which the shape or form of organisms can still be seen. On his travels, Darwin noticed that the fossils in the bottom layers are very different from the organisms alive today. From this, Darwin concluded that organisms have not remained the same since Earth's beginning and that they have changed a lot, gradually becoming more and more complex. He also realized that a new species arises, other ones become extinct. Similarities among living organisms. One type of evidence for evolution is that organisms are similar to each other, but not exactly the same. Similar organisms have differences that help them adapt to their environments. Many organisms have similar body plans. Horses, donkeys, and zebras' bodies are set up in virtually the same way because they are descended from a common ancestor. As organisms adapt and evolve, not everything about them changes. The differences, such as zebra stripes, show that each species adapted to its own environment after branching off from the common ancestor. Another important type of evidence that Darwin studied and that is still studied and used today is artificial selection or breeding. When Darwin returned to England from his voyage on the Beagle, he talked to people who bred pigeons. Darwin realized that breeding works much the same way as his ideas about natural selection, and that many of the same methods that breeders use can also occur in nature and can explain the way organisms change in nature. Next, coming to drawbacks of Darwin's theory of evolution. The weak points allowing the criticism of Darwinism are numerous and interrelated. The Darwinian theory of natural selection tries to explain the disappearance of non-optimal genetic modifications by lesser or lack of adaptations of individuals to the environment. But it does not say anything about the origin of modifications or about the process in which they are carried out. The process of evolution is not in the changes in the genetic information, but rather the disappearance of the less favorable changes. In Darwin's time, there was no genetic knowledge, but they knew that something goes from some generation to others. What Darwin observed was very small variation in the length and breadth of the beaks of finches. Darwin actually noted variation within a species or variation of a kind. These variations in the birds' beaks were so minor that later visitors to the islands had trouble identifying the variations. Darwin actually observed was microevolution or variation within one species of birds, which we all see all the time. Darwin did not observe macroevolution, the changing of one species to another, for example, a lizard turning into a bird. Macroevolution has never been observed by anybody. Macroevolution is defined as the mutation of one species to another species and has never been observed. Since evolution is supposed to happen very slowly, there should be plenty of examples of evolution all around us, with new species being formed all the time. The main problem was that Darwin relied on the purely observational evidence of inheritance and variation, but did not have an understanding of how inheritance worked or how variation was replenished, rather than species evolving to a state of uniform fitness with no variation. This was solved with the discovery of genetics as the basis of heredity and the many mechanisms of mutation, which is the source of new variation, as well as the mechanics of sexual recombination. The next main problem is that there are clearly traits that can survive in a population despite the fact that they are not subject to selection, or in some cases are harmful, and we would expect them to disappear completely due to selection. This was solved with the understanding of recessive genes and with the concept of genetic drift, which is the key part of the field called population genetics. The fossil record occasionally showed sporadic and relatively sudden appearances of major new forms. This contradicted Darwin's concept of strict gradualism, that evolution occurred at a steady invariant pace. So far in today's lecture, we have discussed several aspects of Darwin's theory. Now we can conclude the section. Darwin's theory of evolution fundamentally changed the direction of future scientific thought, though it was built on a growing body of thought that began to question prior ideas about the natural world. The core of Darwin's theory is natural selection, a process that occurs over successive generations and is defined as the differential reproduction of genotypes. Natural selection requires heritable variation in a given trait, and differential survival and reproduction associated with position of the trait. Even though his theory is most acceptable, it also has some drawbacks. Thank you.